So should I?
All right.
Should I start now? Should I wait one more minute? What should I do?
Let's wait 1 minute and then I'll.
Yeah. Yeah. Hello, everybody. So can you see my screen or do you see the black, the black boxes where, you know, Zoom is?
I can see your screen, although there's some there is some black where I think Zoom is. Yeah. I'm not sure why that's happening.
Probably my setting. Let's see how, because I would like to talk seeing somebody, you know, instead of talking alone, but I would like to know how to move this thing out of my, well, whatever, we can manage this.
Okay, all right, let's get started.
Okay, let's get started, and I will put my, you know, timer otherwise.
Perfect. So here, I'll give you an intro and then I'll turn it over to you. Okay. All right, good afternoon, good afternoon, everyone. Okay.
I think somebody needs to mute.
Let's. Make sure everyone is muted except for me. There we go. Okay. All right. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's Kelsey Museum Virtual Flash Talk. We would like to begin today's program by acknowledging that we are presenting from the traditional homelands of the Anishinaabeg, the Three Fires people, who are Ojibwe, Odawa, and Potawatomi, along with their neighbors, the Seneca, Delaware, Shawnee, and Wyandot nations. We further acknowledge that our university stands, like almost all property in the United States, on lands obtained through generally unconscionable ways from Indigenous peoples. As we live and learn on these territories, we must keep in mind the community struggles for self-determination and colonial legacies of scholarly practices. Knowing where we live and work does not change the past, but a thorough understanding of the ongoing consequences of this past can empower us in our research, teaching, and outreach to create a future that supports human flourishing and justice for all individuals. For those of you who are new to this format, a flash talk is a brief presentation about a current research project, followed by a lengthy Q&A. Our presentation today should last about 15 minutes, and then we will have 15 minutes for questions. During our Q&A time, please use the chat feature to type in your questions or the raise your hand icon, at which point you may unmute yourself and ask your question. We do ask that you mute yourself following the question so we don't get any extra feedback. Finally, this event is being recorded and will be available on our website and YouTube channel at a later date. Our speaker today is Kelsey research scientist Laura Motta. Laura is a paleoethnobotanist and the director of the environmental lab for the Gabi project in Italy. She will be speaking today about her current work on the environmental history of the Tiber River Valley and its importance on the development of the special culture and society in that region. So welcome, Laura.
Thank you, Mallory, for the introduction, and thank you everybody that is attending again, possibly, to offer me the opportunity to represent my research and actually, you know, my current thinking, because this is, as Mallory said, ongoing research. So today I'm going to talk about the Tiber River. And, you know, it's a symbol of Rome. You know, we cannot imagine Rome without the Tiber. And indeed, this is, you know, the image that has been chosen for the talk, the upper one, you know, is Rome with the Tiber. But actually today I would like to present the river before it was, you know, heavily urbanized. And so a view of the river that is more, you know, like the one in the lower picture. That is actually being taken just, you know, a few kilometers north of Rome. So it's still like that. So the river has always been an important feature, of course, in the landscape of Rome. And so important that so much of the scholarship emphasize how actually Rome is Rome. Rome became the great Rome because of the river. So the people, you know, people choose that location because there was the river, because there was a possibility of an harbor, because there was a ford that, you know, allowed the crossing of the river, because there was the Tiber island. And so in a very, you know, environmental deterministic view, you know, Rome became the great Rome and not any other of the close by budding cities in the first millennium BC, because there was the Tiber. And this rhetoric is so much entrenched in modern scholarship, but also in, you know, layman way of thinking. And the fascist period, okay, had a role in it. So Mussolini actually moved the boundary of Tuscany westward, pushed westward the boundary of Tuscany to be able to say, to kind of, to emphasize that the source of the river were in his home, in the county of his hometown, Forlì. So, you know, the river is coming from Monte Fumaiolo, that is physically in Tuscany, but is, you know, administratively now in Emilia-Romagna. And Mussolini put a fascist monument, okay, in the middle of the woods, celebrating the great river for the great Rome. And actually there is an inscription that says, qui nasce il fiume sacro ai destini di Roma. Here the river is born that was sacred to the fate of Rome, okay? So this is the kind of rhetoric that we are talking about. So the image of the river, the connection, right, with the landscape is also part of the eternal city rhetoric, okay? So the river and the city are somehow frozen in time. And indeed, as we can see up in the Forma Urbis, right, the marble map of Rome, the imperial marble map of Rome, you know, there is the river more in the same position as it is today. And you know, modern embankments built in after 1870, okay, so after Italy was kind of becoming a nation state, kind of repropose, okay, the same river course and the same landscape. That something was not quite right in this, you know, in this story, was coming up when, as a part of the Santo Mobono project, so an excavation project sponsored by the Kelsey Museum and University of Michigan, where we were excavating the first temple of Rome, right? Beginning of the 6th century BCE. And this temple, as you can see from the pictures, is quite deep down, okay? And it would have been built not only on the shore of the river, but also below the water level. And this didn't really make any sense, okay? So to really understand better the relation of, you know, the river, the landscape, the early city, we started a coring survey. Why coring? Well, because, you know, if you want really to understand what is going on below the modern surface, you cannot just excavate here and there in Rome, right? And so coring allow us to have kind of very specific, I mean, very constrained in space information, but we can have, you know, a series of them and we can correlate them, okay? So how does it work? First of all, it's not so easy to call in Rome because of course it's a modern city. You cannot just, you know, create, you know, a sort of Swiss cheese everywhere. And you have infrastructure below, you know, the modern surface. But once you find the right spot, eventually you are able to extract a sequence of the alluvial stratification and archaeological stratification that allows you to understand what is going on, okay, below the surface. And the cores are studied, right? Looking for different in colors, textures, inclusions, sediment, grain size, okay, like the analysis that we did, you see here on the right, because the river deposits, deposits are different depending on the behavior of the river, okay, and where the river is in the alluvial valley. So you can reconstruct the dynamic, events in the alluvial valley looking at what kind of deposits the river left. We did also other kind of analysis because sometimes the sequence of, you know, this alluvial deposit did not really make sense or match expectation. There was something wrong going on. I mean, something wrong in terms of expectation of a normal river field. And so we look at, you know, paleomagnetic signals to understand, you know, the correlation between different clay deposits in the river valley. We look at a micromorphology section, as you can see here, again on the right, to see, you know, why certain deposits were looking strange. And, you know, you don't see so much, you know, you don't have a clue by naked eye, but, you know, with micromorphology, you can look at processes, sedimentological processes at a microscope. And for example, you can see, you know, that you have horizontal layers like in the upper slide and that are normal in a river, right? Where the sediment is deposited by the water is usually horizontal, but you can have also a situation which this structure, you know, this horizontal like cake structure has been disturbed, okay? And that is a kind of alarm bell that you need to understand what is going on there. The third step is to understand where, when, okay, those deposits has been deposited, and so chronology. And, you know, of course, for the archaeological stratigraphy, we use pottery and other, you know, cultural material, but below the archaeological stratigraphy, we need to use other dating methods, mostly radiocarbon dating. And so we need to, you know, find the right material to be dated. Once we have, you know, some understanding of the different sediments, and we have, you know, the chronology of the different section of the course, we need to kind of combine them, okay, compare them and align them in a way that we make horizontal, you know, bands that represent periods of time in a way that we can understand what is going on in the valley in each period. So now I'm telling you what actually we were able to see in the course, okay? I'm starting at 6,000 years ago. Okay, we can actually start earlier, but the story is a little bit boring. So as you can see in the inset below here, the black line, okay, this is the rate of the sedimentation. So how quick the sea level, the black line, was kind of rising after the last glacial period. So after 14,000 years ago. And it was a steep line, right? So, you know, it goes from minus 80 meters, I think, 14,000 years ago, below sea, modern sea level, up to more or less zero to 6,000 BC. And the blue line is what we see in the Tiber River Valley. So, you know, we have a very matching, okay, curve. So also the Tiber, of course, was kind of raising is the valley floor in kind of synchrony with the sea level. And why I'm starting at 6,000 years ago? Because that is an interesting moment in which, you know, this trend is kind of slowing down, is almost stopping, okay? As you can see the plateau in the blue line. And is 6,000 years ago, we are more or less in the Neolithic, right, in terms of archaeological period for the area, okay? And the landscape was completely different from what we see today. It was really a gigantic swamp. So the coastline was closer. This was a sort of a big estuarine area for the Tiber. And it was swampy and included this formation that is called alder karst. So a swamp that has, you know, alder as the main characteristic species. So the implication here are several, and I have not quite digested all the information, so I cannot really tell you about the Neolithic in Rome. But clearly, you know, there is some thinking to do in terms of, you know, how people could have exploited this sort of landscape. And this landscape is you know, in a big area. It's not just the valley, also the tributary valleys. So it's a really big region that is like that. So how people would have exploited this landscape, where they would have been living at that time. So where we should expect to find settlements and where we shouldn't, because they would be below, you know, not accessible, right, for modern day archaeology. At a certain point, things are kind of getting messy in the Tiber Valley. So, you know, the Tiber doesn't behave anymore like, you know, the sea. And that is something that shouldn't happen, right? Because the river that goes in the sea should behave like the sea in terms of, you know, difference in elevation. But actually what we see, and we don't see that just in our course, but in different course also, you know, in the modern delta, is that the river all of a sudden, more or less in geological terms, carve a different bed and goes down again, 10 meters down, 30 feet down, okay? And here in the image, you see this kind of old, okay, course of the river, more or less 6,000, between 6,000 and 5,000 years ago. And so this is, again, you know, is 1,000 years, but it's quite quick as a change. And again, has huge implications for the landscape because basically it drains all the swamp and create the kind of drier valley that we, you know, we envision today. Oh, I already finished 15 minutes. Okay, so I will be very quick. The vegetation goes in the same direction from the pollen. So we see the alder karst, and we see, you know, complete disruption of the vegetation, probably a lot of flooding, probably a lot of erosion. If we move in time, the valley starts to refill, okay, so to behave in a normal way. And we don't know about this anomaly of, you know, 6,000, 5,000. We don't know the explanation. And so during the Bronze Age, the valley starts to refill again. And probably what we see is that the river moves inside the valley quite a few times. Okay, so it's not always close to Rome. Sometimes it's close to what we call nowadays Trastevere. And again, these are huge implications because what we know now is that the first archaeological evidence that is in the middle late Bronze Age in Rome on the Capitoline Hill actually is when the river was not close to Rome. The river was on the other side of the valley. So if they picked that spot, was not because they had the river just below. Okay. Moving forward, we have the first settlement in Rome and the river on the other side. Dry valleys in between the hilltops, but all of a sudden, and this is when the temple has been built, okay? All of a sudden, the river shifts closer to the to the hills, okay? And to the location of Rome. And but the temple is still, on a sort of terrace because the river is much lower than what we thought before, okay? So, the river is low, the valley floor is low, and the temple is up on a terrace. So it does make sense. Fine, but why the temple goes under waters? Because in the sea, and this is a reconstruction of the landscape, okay? So with the temple, the possible place where the arbor was, the star, the modern river is the kind of dotted blue line. And this is the reconstruction of the original morphology, okay, in the sixth century, according to our course. So dry valleys, as I said, so one of the big implications of that is that one, they were not crazy building temples underwater. Two, that swampy early Rome, like is always portrayed, not really. So there might be some swamp here and there. I mean, it's a alluvial valley, but the valleys in between the hilltops where the huts were, usable. But why we have this idea of, floods and the temple was going physically underwater, center point in the late sixth century? Well, because all of a sudden there are catastrophic floods. And if these catastrophic floods are, triggered by climatic events, by the urbanization process and so deforestation, by tectonics, so we have evidence of fault lines that are kind of moving the river, shifting the river in the current position and lowering and filling up the valley again. So there are several, factors that are affecting the landscape in the sixth century. But, what is, I think, very interesting here is that is something that is happening. So the perception that we have of Rome is something that is actually happening all of a sudden, is quite a catastrophic event again in the sixth century that is changing the landscape, okay? And raised the valley floor of several meters. So this is how the same area looks like two centuries after, okay, in the fifth century. So the river is shifted, not quite in the modern position, but almost. The level is much higher. The arbor moves from, a sort of natural landing to probably a built infrastructure where it stays till the second century BCE. And this is, is the starting point of the eternal city in a way, okay? Because at that point, they pave the area, they build the temple, and nothing will change anymore. Thank you. And sorry, I was longer. You are muted.
I am muted, thank you. Does anyone have any questions for Laura? You can type them into the chat, or at this point you can feel free to unmute yourselves and ask any questions.
So an end.
No questions.
Okay, well, thank you.
Thank you again, Laura, for the presentation, and thank you everyone for joining us today. If you do have any questions, you can always contact the museum, things that come up. You can join us next month, November 5th, for our next flash talk, which we will be streaming live from Giza. So we hope you all join us next time, and thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, everybody, for your attention. Bye, Mallory.
Bye.